Good morning, Billy. An object goes straight down a vertical distance h. Please determine the work on the object done by the force of gravity during this motion.
Flippin' physics.
Because the force of gravity is constant, the work done on the object by the force of gravity equals force of gravity times displacement times cosine theta. We use the magnitudes of both the force of gravity and displacement. Force of gravity equals mass times acceleration due to gravity. The magnitude of the displacement equals h. The force of gravity is down, and the displacement is down, so the angle between those two directions is zero. So the work done on the object by the force of gravity equals mass times acceleration due to gravity times height h. Oh, and that equals the gravitational potential energy of the mass, right?
Very nice, Billy, and we will get to the relationship between work and potential energy very soon. Not yet, though. Bobby, if the object instead slides down an incline of angle alpha through the same vertical distance h, please find the work done on the object by the force of gravity in terms of h.
Okay, we have the same work equation. Force of gravity is still mass times acceleration due to gravity. The displacement now is the displacement parallel to the incline, which we can label delta d parallel. And the angle between the direction of the force of gravity, or straight down, and the direction of the displacement of the object, or down the incline, is, well, it's 90 minus the angle alpha. We need a relationship between displacement parallel and height h. Sine of alpha equals opposite over hypotenuse, or h over delta d parallel. That means the displacement parallel equals h over sine alpha. Oh, and sine and cosine have the same shape, it's just they are phase shifted 90 degrees from one another. In other words, sine alpha equals cosine of 90 minus alpha. Therefore, the work done by the force of gravity on the object equals mass times acceleration due to gravity times h over sine alpha, all times sine alpha. Sine alpha cancels out, and we are left with mass times acceleration due to gravity times height h, which is exactly the same as the work done on the object by the force of gravity when it went straight down a distance h instead.
Exactly. And furthermore, no matter what the angle of the incline is, the work done on the object by the force of gravity as the object goes down a distance h is the same. It always equals mass times acceleration due to gravity times height h. This is because the work done on an object by the force of gravity is independent of the path taken by the object. That makes the force of gravity a conservative force.
A conservative force?
Right. A conservative force. A force where the work done on an object by the force is the same regardless of what path the object moves through. Examples of conservative forces are the gravitational force, the spring force, the electromagnetic force between two charged particles, and the magnetic force between two magnetic poles. Now, let's get to what Billy realized. Notice that the change in gravitational potential energy of the object in this example equals negative mass times acceleration due to gravity times height h. This is because no matter where we set the zero line for gravitational potential energy, the change in height of the object will equal negative h. Also, notice that the work done on the object by the force of gravity equals the negative of the change in gravitational potential energy of the object. Again, this is no matter what path the object goes through. That is because the work done by a conservative force equals the negative of the change in potential energy of the object, which is associated with that force. For example, gravitational potential energy goes with the force of gravity, elastic potential energy goes with spring force, and electric potential energy goes with the electromagnetic force. Okay, now let's look at the work done on the object by the force of friction during the same event. In other words, as the object slides down an incline through the same vertical distance h. Bo, please determine the work done on the object by the force of friction in this case.
Sure. We still have the same work equation, though the force is now the force of kinetic friction. So the equation is the coefficient of kinetic friction times force normal times the same parallel displacement Bobby identified times the cosine of, Well, the force of kinetic friction is up the incline, and the displacement is down the incline, and the angle between those up and down the incline directions is 180 degrees. In order to determine the normal force, we need to sum the forces in the parallel direction. In order to do that, we need the free body diagram.
Thank you, Bob.
Yeah. The force normal is up and perpendicular to the incline. The force of kinetic friction is up the incline. The force of gravity is straight down, but we can break that into its components, parallel to and down the incline, and perpendicular to the incline and down. The net force in the perpendicular direction equals force normal minus force of gravity perpendicular, which equals mass times acceleration in the perpendicular direction. However, the object is not accelerating perpendicular to the incline. So force normal equals force of gravity perpendicular, which equals mass times acceleration due to gravity times cosine of the incline angle alpha. I remember it's cosine because if the incline angle were 0 degrees, then the force of gravity perpendicular would just equal mass times acceleration due to gravity, and the cosine of 0 degrees equals 1.
Very nice.
Yeah. We can substitute that back into the equation for force normal. And we already know we can substitute h over sine alpha for displacement parallel. And the cosine of 180 degrees equals negative 1. Cosine alpha over sine alpha equals cotangent alpha. That means the work done by the force of kinetic friction as the object slides down the incline equals negative coefficient of kinetic friction times mass times acceleration due to gravity times height h times cotangent alpha.
Thanks, Bo. Now, you should be able to see from the equation Bo just solved for that the work done by the force of friction on the object changes depending on the angle of the incline, or alpha, in that work equation. That means that the work done by the force of friction is dependent on the path taken by the object, which makes the force of friction a non-conservative force.
A non-conservative force.
Right. Friction is a non-conservative force. So those are useful examples, but let's now identify the two equivalent properties of all conservative forces. First, the work done by a conservative force on an object moving between any two points is independent of the path taken by the object. And second, the work done by a conservative force on an object moving through any closed path equals zero, where a closed path is defined as a path where the initial and final points are the same location. If a force does not have those two equivalent properties, it is not a conservative force. It is a non-conservative force. Clearly, we have shown the first equivalent property to be true. Let's look at work done on an object as it moves through a closed path in order to investigate the second property. Again, we have already shown that the work done on an object by the force of gravity equals mass times acceleration due to gravity times height, regardless of the path taken. For a closed path, the initial and final heights will be the same, and the work done on the object by the force of gravity will equal zero. That shows that the force of gravity has the second equivalent property necessary to be a conservative force. As an object goes through a closed path, the work done on the object by the force of gravity equals zero. Now, let's look at conservative forces in more detail. If we have an object on a level surface and we displace that object a straight line distance d from an initial to a final point, the work done by the force of friction on the object, let's call this work A because the object goes through path A, we can calculate work A to be, well, because the force of kinetic friction is constant, the work equals force of kinetic friction times displacement A times cosine theta. Force of kinetic friction equals the coefficient of kinetic friction times force normal, the displacement of the object equals the distance d, and the angle between the direction of the force of kinetic friction and the displacement of the object is 180 degrees because they are in opposite directions. And that means we need the force normal. For that, we need to sum the forces in the y direction. The net force in the y direction equals force normal minus...
I think you forgot the free body diagram.
Thank you, Bo. That is a good point. In order to sum the forces, we need the free body diagram of all the forces acting on the object. Force normal acts up, force of gravity acts down, force applied acts to the right, force of kinetic friction acts to the left. The net force in the y direction then equals force normal minus force of gravity, which equals mass times acceleration in the y direction. There's no acceleration of the object in the y direction, therefore the force normal equals the force of gravity, which equals mass times acceleration due to gravity. We can substitute that back into our original work equation, and we get that the work done on the object by the force of friction as it goes through a straight line distance d equals negative coefficient of kinetic friction times mass times acceleration due to gravity times distance d. That is work A, or the work done on the object by the force of friction as the object goes through path A. Now let's change the example. Let's tie a string to the object and move it from the same initial point to the same final point. This time, the path of the object will form a half circle. Billy, please determine the work done on the object by the force of friction now, and let's call this work B and path B.
Okay, work B equals force of kinetic friction times displacement B times cosine theta. We can substitute in the equation for force of kinetic friction. The magnitude of displacement B is half the circumference of the circle, and theta is... Well, let's draw a free body diagram. The force of gravity is down, and the force normal is up. The force of tension in the string is always in towards the center of the circle. The force applied is always tangent to the circle, and in the direction of motion. And the force of kinetic friction is always tangent to the circle and opposite the direction of motion. That means the angle between the direction of the force of kinetic friction and the direction of the displacement of the object is always 180 degrees. We have the same forces and zero acceleration in the y direction, so force normal still equals mass times acceleration due to gravity. Circumference equals pi times diameter, or pi times d, so half the circumference equals pi times d over 2. That means the work done by the force of kinetic friction on the object equals negative pi over 2 times coefficient of kinetic friction times mass times acceleration due to gravity times d. Oh, and that does not equal the work done when going through path A. In other words, the work done by the force of friction on the object is different depending on the path taken by the object. That, again, shows that the force of friction is a non-conservative force because it does not have the first of the two equivalent properties of conservative forces you mentioned earlier. Cool.
That is exactly right, Billy. The difference here is that more energy has been converted to thermal energy when going along path B than when going along path A, because path B was longer than path A. The work that went into the system via the force applied moving the object was converted into thermal energy in the object and the surface via work done by the force of friction. Now, we should know, because the two conservative force properties are equivalent, that the force of friction will also not have the second equivalent property. The work over a closed path for the force of friction will not equal zero. However, let's confirm that. Let's determine the work done by the force of friction acting on an object moving through one full circle of radius d over 2. In other words, from the original initial point all the way through one circumference back to that same point. Bo, please determine the work done by the force of friction on the object in this case. And let's call it work O and path O.
Well, this is actually very similar to what Billy just did. The only difference is that the magnitude of the displacement for path O equals the circumference of the circle, or pi times d. That means the work done for path O equals twice the work Billy got, because the distance traveled by the object is twice the distance in path B. And the work done by the force of friction when going through path O, which is a closed loop, clearly does not equal zero. So the work done by the force of friction on an object over a closed path does not equal zero, and the force of friction is a non-conservative force, which we already knew.
Correct, Bo. Again, work done by the force of friction converts kinetic energy into thermal energy, and the object and surface get warmer after going through the circle than they were before when going through the half circle. One last thing I'll point out is that a more basic definition of conservative forces is that conservative forces are forces that can return the kinetic energy back to the system after taking it away, and therefore mechanical energy is conserved. And we can use conservation of mechanical energy, hence conservative forces. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.